So if we talk about this same example where we have flow that is running perpendicular to the plane of the slice that we're imaging. Okay. And we said that if we're using a gradient echo pulse sequence, where we have our slice selective RF pulse, we phase encode, and then we frequency encode at TE, said that this issue of high velocity signal loss doesn't pertain. It doesn't matter, right, how fast the spins are moving, because they only have to see this one slice selective RF pulse. By the way, even though those spins might be flowing and might have ended up outside of the slice at the time we sample the signal, it really doesn't matter. Because all of this spatial encoding, these gradient magnetic fields, are equally present throughout the scanner. If we would have flow that was running exactly perpendicular to the slice, the spins would be in the slice for the RF and would have gone through the slice, and by the time we start phase and frequency encoding, we would still localize the signal to exactly the right place in our image. Is that clear why that is? Yes, no, not really. Has nothing to do with velocity, no, because the spins are moving perpendicular to the slice. So when we apply the phase encoding gradient, let's say phase encoding, right, let's say that this phase encoding gradient is being applied along this dimension of the slice. When we turn on the phase encoding gradient magnetic field, that gradient magnetic field is present every place. So whether the spins are in the slice at this point along the gradient magnetic field, or whether they are outside the slice along the gradient magnetic field, they see exactly the same gradient magnetic field strength. The same thing is true for the frequency encoding gradient magnetic field. So even though all of this might be occurring while those spins are already outside of the slice, they're still going to be spatially encoded. And unless they're so far gone that they're out of range of the receiver coil that we're using, we'll detect their signal just the same. So it's just kind of interesting to think about the fact that when you have flow like this that is perpendicular to your slice, that the signal at the time you sample it might not even be in the slice anymore, but you still detect it and put it there. Okay? Now, there's something about this scenario, though, that we need to think of, which is that if we look at what is happening in this gradient echo pulse sequence, where let's say that our TR, right, is whatever it is, but it's not extremely long like a typical gradient echo pulse sequence. Look at what's happening to our stationary and flowing spins. When we give this very first RF pulse, we generate signal, and that signal starts to relax. And assuming, just to make things easy, let's assume that the stationary tissue in the blood has the same T1, T2, T2 star. They all relax at the same rate. And if we give our next RF pulse after TR before they've fully relaxed, we have a little bit less magnetization, a little less signal than we had the first time around. And when we iterate our pulse sequence again and give the next 90 degree RF pulse, we knock them down into the transverse plane once more. We've put them into a steady state. But in this example, where let's say the flow is so slow, hypothetically, that the flowing spins see each successive RF pulse, they look exactly the same. The spins are all in this lower, steady state. They recover the same amount of magnetization after each TR and go back and generate the same amount of signal. The reality, of course, is that after one TR, where we recover part of the way, knock those spins down again, the flowing spins are long gone. And when we recover the next time around, the flowing spins have been replaced by some that were further downstream that have moved into the slice. They have never seen the effect of any of these RF pulses. And on the next successive RF pulse, there is going to be a large amount of magnetization. They are fully relaxed. And when we generate our signal with that next RF pulse, we have much more signal from the spins that have just flowed into that slice than the ones that were stationary. Okay? And this phenomenon is called flow related enhancement. Sometimes it's called a time of flight effect.
God bless you.
Now, this is not going to be unique, by the way, to this gradient. Yes?
But if it's just a flowing, it's not excited, right?
Why?
Excitation is along the slice.
That's right.
So it's out of the slice coming in. Those spins, they are not excited. How come they have trans?
No. So the first RF pulse looks like this.
Okay.
And these spins relax.
One second.
But the next RF pulse, we have new blood that has come in and looks like this. So it's because the inflowing spins are excited, and they have a larger amount of longitudinal magnetization. Okay. So this phenomenon will occur anytime you have flow that is perpendicular to the plane of the slice. Okay. Now, this example is a gradient echo pulse sequence. What if this were a spin echo pulse sequence? If we make this into a spin echo pulse sequence, let's look at what happens. On our first RF pulse, we knock these spins down, generate signal. The stationary spins and the flowing spins are relaxing with T2 star. When we give the 180 degree RF pulse, the stationary spins start to recover some transverse magnetization, some signal. The flowing spin, since they have left the slice, high velocity signal loss, they never get refocused, they are going to relax very rapidly. But on the second successive RF pulse, there is now new blood that has come in, and will have a lot more longitudinal magnetization than the stationary spins. So when we apply our next RF pulse, we have at the beginning more signal from the flowing blood than we do from the stationary spins. They both are going to lose signal with T2 star. At some point, the 180 degree pulse will have its effect on the stationary spins, but not on those flowing spins because they have left the slice. Right? And when we measure the signal at TE, these will be a lot more similar. Now still, because of that inflow, because there was so much more longitudinal magnetization at the outset, there's still going to be higher signal from the inflowing spins than the stationary tissue. So this flow-related enhancement, or inflow effect, or whatever you want to call it, will even occur in the setting of a spin echo pulse sequence. But it will be enhanced, it will be most apparent, right, when we use a gradient echo pulse sequence. So if you wanted to maximize your ability to see this time of flight effect, you would choose to use a gradient echo pulse sequence. Okay, one other thing about this effect. So typically, when we are imaging, we don't image a single slice. Right, we image some stack of slices, which means that we are exciting a whole series of slices. And if we compare what's going on at this slice on the right-hand side of the stack, right, we'll call this slice number 5, relative to slice number 1 over here on our left. Well, slice number 1, the situation is as we just described it. We have all of this inflowing blood, which has a lot more longitudinal magnetization than our steady state stationary spins. And therefore, we have a lot more signal from flowing blood on each successive RF pulse. But as those spins flow through this stack of slices, they will have the opportunity, so to speak, right, to get the effect of this RF at multiple locations. By the time we get to slice number 5, it's very possible that even those inflowing spins have seen several RF pulses and have also become saturated, just like the stationary spins. So this effect of augmented signal due to the inflowing spins will essentially be lost as we get further into our stack of slices. The larger the number of slices, and actually the shorter the TR, right, the more likely we're going to have attenuation of this flow-related enhancement. And what this means is that if we look at an example, let's say we're imaging the head with a series of slices, we might expect that if we look at the inferiormost slice, that we will see high signal in this case, the arteries, where blood is flowing in from outside. Right? And on each successive RF pulse used to image this slice, we have fresh, fully relaxed blood that has entered the slice. Whereas getting further into the stack, maybe at this point, we would have much lower signal. If it were a spin echo pulse sequence, we might actually start to have absence or low signal, that high velocity signal loss. Okay. So this phenomenon has also sometimes been called an entry slice effect. Right? And typically we will see that appearance of flow-related enhancement showing up in those inferior-most slices in the volume. You could also potentially see it on the other end if you have flow coming in from the other direction, like venous flow in this example. All right, any questions about this? Okay, let's just look at an example. Okay, so these images are simply, right, these are simply T1 weighted spin echo images. And this is the bottom slice in the stack from a head exam. So if you look at these two white dots, these are the vertebral arteries. Right, in our spin echo image, we would typically expect arterial blood to be what? Black. Someone said flow void, right? You would expect to have very low signal in a spin echo pulse sequence due to high velocity signal loss. Well, the process that leads to high velocity signal loss is still operational here. The spins flowing through these segments of the vertebral artery are flowing so fast that they do not see the 90 and the 180 degree RF pulse. But they have so much longitudinal magnetization because they flowed in from outside that we still see this flow-related enhancement or this time of flight effect. And if you move up in the stack, it's not as apparent. Now, if we keep going here, all of a sudden, you see even more flow-related enhancement. That sort of doesn't make sense, according to what I just explained to you. I said that if we're looking at some patient, right, that as we flow into our stack of slices, we should see progressively less and less flow-related enhancement. So what's going on?
This was taken immediately after the first slice,
right? Sorry?
This was taken after the first image.
Oh, I'm showing them out of order? Is that what you're saying?
No, the way you acquire the images, I thought you said yesterday you go like 1, then 3,
exactly.
Then 5,
okay.
Then 7.
So you're exactly right. This is interleaving. Right? So we don't acquire the slices in order. And as I indicated the other day, that you know the vendors may have different schemes for how they interleave the slices. So you won't necessarily see a clear one-to-one progression. Then as you go to the next slice, you notice that they are smaller and even less over here. Now if you notice, you can see that little sort of dot of white in the basilar artery. So something to realize when we look at what has happened here is not only is the magnitude of the flow-related enhancement less, but it almost looks like the diameter of the vessel, or at least of the area where we see this flow-related enhancement, is getting smaller. What's that about? Exactly. That has to do with our laminar flow, that the smaller velocities are at the periphery and the higher velocities are at the center of the vessel. The higher the velocity, if we're acquiring a stack of slices, the farther those unsaturated new spins can get into the volume before they become saturated. The slower velocities will become saturated earlier on. So what we're seeing is the highest velocity flow in the center of the vessel still has substantial flow-related enhancement, whereas the periphery has already been saturated. This is really important because this is the basis for time-of-flight MR angiography, which is the workhorse of MRA that you guys use. Okay. What type of image is this? Anyone? Radiologist, what do you say? What type of image is this? Yeah, this is a T2 weighted image. The TE for this image was somewhere around 120 milliseconds. It's a long TE. So if you look at the signal, and this is a spin echo, it's actually fast spin echo, but it's a pulse sequence that employs spin echoes. If you look at the signal within the blood vessels, it's extremely dark. More so than on our T1 weighted spin echo image, which was probably acquired with a TE right on the order of 14 or something, 14 milliseconds or something like that. So this is showing you that the TE, which lengthens the period of time between the 90 and the 180 degree pulse, also confers a much greater degree of high velocity signal loss. Look at this area. You see how there is a black line, and to the right of it there's a white line? Okay. This is a vessel that is flowing in plane. And because it's flowing in plane on an oblique, we end up with phase misregistration. The signal that's actually in the area of flow in the vessel has been shifted to the right. Right? This goes back to what we talked about, where there was a differential in time between where the spins were when we were phase encoding and where they were when they were frequency encoding. Now, in this example, if this were the phase encoding direction in the image, and this were the frequency encoding direction, what can we say about the direction of flow in that blood vessel? Well, we could do it by trial and error. Could it be that the flow was in this direction? Why not? If flow is in this direction, that would mean that it would have been phase encoded, right, spatially encoded at this location first. I didn't mean to do that. What does that mean? Right, it would have been phase encoded here, frequency encoded here. Phase encoded at this location, frequency encoded at this location would shift the signal to this side of the vessel. That's the opposite of what we have. Flow has to be moving in this direction. Okay? All right. So any questions then about any of these flow phenomena? High velocity signal loss, flow-related enhancement, turbulence-induced dephasing, gradient-induced dephasing. Okay. So when we talk about MRA, or magnetic resonance angiography, we're interested in generating images where there is a clear difference between signal from flowing blood and everything else. So again, similar to the sort of MR urogram, MRCP techniques we talked about yesterday, we're really interested in low contrast types of images. All we want to do is maximize, right, the difference in signal between flow and everything else, right? Or what we sometimes call the background, the stationary spins. That's the name of the game, so to speak. Now, there are two ways we could go about doing that. We could try and augment the signal related to flow, or we could try and minimize the signal from the background. Now, what steps could you take that would increase, right, the signal intensity of flowing blood? Based on what we've discussed. Well, which one of these flow phenomena that we discussed gives us higher signal from flowing blood?
Gradient.
Right, the time of flight effect, which was going to be most pronounced if we used a gradient echo image. So what we're going to do is set up a pulse sequence where we're seeing the effect of blood that is flowing into the slice that has not seen any RF pulses. And gradient echo would be the optimal choice. If we're looking at relatively high flow velocities, using a spin echo image simply means that our flow is never going to be refocused, and we're going to have lower signal. So what else could you do to augment signal from flow?
Increase the magnetic field.
I'm sorry?
Increase the magnetic field.
Okay, so you could use higher magnetic field strength. That's true. And MRA is much better at higher field strength than it is at lower field strength. You have to realize, though, that this increases the signal from everything. It's not exclusive to flow. What else could you do if you wanted to maximize the signal due to flow? Decrease the TE. Why?
Thank you.
We want to capture all of that signal before it has any chance to decay. We're not using TE to generate image contrast in the traditional way. So by making our TE as short as possible, we will make sure that we capture the most flow-related signal that we can. What else? Well, think about the mechanisms that might lead to signal loss in the vessel. Okay, so a contrast agent, that's something else. You could potentially give a contrast agent. That would work if the contrast agent was intravascular. If the contrast agent gets out into the stationary tissue, it doesn't help. But more importantly, if we're talking about this time of flight effect, where we're relying on the magnetization of inflowing spins that are fully relaxed, how does a contrast agent augment that signal? It really has no effect, because when the spins come into the slice that we're imaging, they're already fully relaxed. Right? Essentially, it's almost like saying that there is no TR for the flowing blood, because every successive RF we give, it's new, fully relaxed blood that has never seen an RF pulse before. So gadolinium, at least in this approach, and we'll talk about contrast-enhanced MRA in a short while, it really doesn't have a role. And it can be problematic if it gets out into the background tissue and enhances that signal. Well, what mechanisms did we have that could lead to signal loss?
You thin the slice?
One is flow within the slice along a gradient magnetic field. And we've already talked about a mechanism that we can use to recover some of that signal that might otherwise be lost, called gradient moment nulling. Right? Those funny applications of the gradient magnetic fields, right? It's not just a curiosity, it actually is an important component of time of flight MRA to recover, right, the component signal from the component of flow that's in the plane of the slice. The vessels we're imaging are never going only perpendicular to the slice. All right. Anything else? Well,
could you make the slices thinner so that you would decrease the signal from the tissue, and then the inflowing blood would be more likely to be a larger component of the slice? Or is the time that we're doing this not make that worthwhile?
I'm not sure how that would make a difference. I'm not sure how that would make a difference.
I guess I'm wondering, is the time scale that we're doing this at such that all of the blood that lost its
signal you mean through the thickness of the slice, is there sort of now a combination of blood?
Yeah.
It's totally refreshed, yeah. At least we'll make that assumption that it's totally refreshed within each TR. It is. Okay. So this would be, right, useful to generate a single gradient echo image that has high signal due to flowing blood. But we all know, right, that whenever we're going to image our patient, right, we're not interested in a single slice. We're always interested in multiple slices. And remember that in the example we looked at over here, where we do multi-slice imaging, that when we get further and further into that stack of slices, there is going to be progressive saturation of our flow-related signal. So one of the approaches that we actually take in doing time of flight MRA is to image one slice in its entirety. So when we iterate through TR, we do our TR again and again and again to to fill up all of K space for that single slice, and only then go on to the next slice. Because otherwise, if we were doing a multi-slice approach where we excited multiple slices within a single TR, we would have significant saturation of the spins. So multi-slice imaging, right, is not a good idea if we're going to do this. Another issue is turbulence. Right? Is there anything you can do to get away from the signal loss that might be encountered due to turbulent flow? And the only way really to do that would be to improve your spatial resolution, to make it a much higher resolution image. So within a given voxel, you don't have as much tortuosity or as much of a stenosis, as much turbulence, because remember, it's the net effect within a voxel that's going to reflect the signal. So all of this is going to allow us to maximize signal due to flow. The other thing we said is that we could decrease signal in the background. One other thing, actually, that I didn't mention here is, what flip angle are you going to use? Not 90? Why not?
Because you're not supposed to use 90 degrees with gradient echo.
That's not necessarily true.
Never mind. Just kidding.
Okay. So we said yesterday, right, that there's some Ernst angle, right, where there's going to be maximal signal intensity for what criteria? This curve is specific to some combination of TR and T1. Right? So for a given tissue imaged at a given TR, there is some angle which will give us maximal signal amplitude. Well, what's the TR as far as flow is concerned? There really is no TR. Or that's the equivalent of saying, if you think about it, that TR is infinitely long. The spins are as relaxed as they can possibly be. It's as if the TR were infinity. What's the T1 of these spins? Okay. They're fully relaxed. We're not observing their longitudinal relaxation. That's the same as saying that the T1 is infinitely short. Now, if we would plot the Ernst angle curve for something with an infinitely short T1 imaged with an infinitely long TR, what would it look like? Would look like that. In that scenario, the max, remember, if the T1 is really long, like our spin echo images where the TR is really long, we're going to get the most signal by using a large flip angle. In typical gradient echo imaging, we're using a narrower flip angle simply because we're imaging with a short TR. But in this case, it's functionally as if the TR is infinitely long. Therefore, the flip angle that will give us the most signal is always going to be 90 degrees. By the way, the same thing is true in single-shot imaging. Right, and we talked about that this morning. I just want to make the point that in a single-shot image where you fill all of K-space after a single excitation, it's functionally as if your TR is infinitely long. And as a result, you'll always get the most signal from using a 90-degree RF. So in single-shot imaging techniques, you always want to be using that maximal excitation, 90-degree excitation. Okay, so going back to the background, what can we do to minimize the signal detectable in the background. Well, the background spins are not moving, right? They don't have an infinitely short T1. TR is relevant to them. How would you choose your TR to minimize signal from the background? You'd make it as short as possible. And if we hadn't even talked about this, and I asked you, how would you choose your flip angle to minimize signal in the background? Well, zero doesn't count. Really? Well, if the TR is extremely short, I shouldn't have erased it. What happens to the Ernst angle curve as the TR gets short? Right? This was our case where the TR was really long. As the TR gets shorter, the Ernst angle curve actually shifts to the left, which means what? Which means that a narrower flip angle gives you more and more signal. A larger and larger flip angle will maximally suppress that signal. You'll get maximum saturation. Think about it. If we're going to knock this down only 45 degrees and hit it again before it recovers very much, we're going to be getting some usable amount of signal. If, on the other hand, we knock it down 90 degrees and barely let it recover before we knock it down again, we are going to be saturating into a much lower steady state. Right? So a small TR and a large, right, flip angle are key to minimizing signal from the background tissue. Anything else? Well, what if, as in this example, what if we're imaging, let's say, in the abdomen? And we're looking at blood vessels that are surrounded by fat. So one thing you can do is you can use things like fat suppression to try and minimize specific components of the background. Or you could choose your TE so that it was, let's say we were imaging at 1.5 Tesla, maybe you would choose a 4.6. No. That's wrong. A 6.9 millisecond TE. Why would you do that? Chemical shift. What happens? At zero, the spins are in phase. At 2.3 milliseconds, they're 180 degrees out of phase. At 4.6, they're back in phase. At 6.9, they're 180 degrees out of phase. So anywhere where you have fat and water, you will be canceling your signal. So it was very common, especially in the past, to choose your TE so that fat and water would be out of phase. It turns out that there are competing interests here, because minimizing the TE, as we already said, maximizes signal due to flow. This was at a time, right, when getting TEs a whole lot shorter than this was not so feasible. If you can image with a TE that's closer to 1 millisecond, you may be better off than taking this approach. Okay. So if you're going to generate an MRA image, it's basically a gradient echo image where you set your parameters to maximize flow-related enhancement and minimize signal due to background. And then all we're really doing, if we think of an example, right, like where you're going to image the carotids in the neck, all we are doing is acquiring a series of slices with those parameters. Slices are very sensitive to flow. They'll have very poor contrast as far as the rest of the tissue goes. Let's look at one other thing that might be important. In this example, flow is going from bottom to top. So if flow is moving in this direction, it actually makes a difference. We already said that we're going to use gradient echo imaging and acquire each slice independently. So acquire all the lines of K-space for the first slice, then for the second slice, no interleaving, no multi-slice imaging. Would it be preferable to acquire the slices from top to bottom or from bottom to top? Or does it make no difference? And you have to decide. Right? When you set up your scan, you actually have a choice. You can say start at the bottom and do the bottom one, then next, or you can start from the top and go the other way. Generally won't allow you to go in some random order. So why would you choose one direction over the other? Any ideas? Let's say you start at the top. So we're going to acquire, let's say, 256 lines of K-space from this slice. Then we move on and we acquire our next 256 lines of K-space from this slice. Well, hold on a second. All of the spins that have flowed into this slice have just been saturated by the RF applied to the slice above. I'm sorry, I'm doing this backwards. If we start at the bottom, right, and we acquire slice number one, and then we acquire slice number two, we have now saturated the flow that is going into slice number two right before we acquired it. So with flow going in one direction, we always want to acquire our slices in the opposite direction. Because by acquiring this slice over here, we're not doing anything to the flow that is going to be coming into the next subsequent slices. So in taking this approach, and this, by the way, is called 2D time of flight MRA. 2D because they are two-dimensional images. Yes?
So you minimize the signal coming from veins then that are going the opposite direction?
So I was actually going to get to that point next. Before we answer that question, which is an excellent question, look at this scenario. So not only do we have flow in the carotids, but we also have flow, let's say, in the jugular veins going in the opposite direction. So if I just take any one of these images, forget about acquiring multiple slices. Let's say I'm just going to acquire a single slice using this 2D time of flight technique. When I take that image, and there are places in this image where I know that there's going to be a vein and an artery. So what will, and we know that the background is suppressed due to the very short TR, the very large flip angle, etc., and we have a large amount of signal due to flow. Will the signal in the artery and the vein look the same? You'll actually have the same amount of flow-related enhancement in both the artery and the vein. Because we're acquiring this single slice, and flow is coming in from two different directions, but the slice doesn't know the difference. Okay. Now, Maria is correct that when we acquire our slices against the flow, we will, to some extent, as we just discussed, be attenuating the flow that's going in the other direction. Okay? Because before we get to slice number two, we have just saturated the flow in the veins that will be going into slice number two when we hit slice number one. That may be sort of more of a curiosity, but in practice, when we look at an MRA of the carotids, and a lot of you have looked at these before, you know that we look at images that show the arterial system. Do you see the jugular vein usually when you look at an MRA of the carotids? No. And we don't want to. If it would be there, it would be in the way. It would make it more difficult to see what we're interested in. No one cares about the veins. So how is it, if the image is equally sensitive to both arterial and venous flow, meaning flow going in, it's not really arterial, venous is totally irrelevant. It's a matter of direction of flow. In the neck, the veins are all going one way, the arteries are all going the other way. So how is it that we generate an image where we only see arteries and we don't see veins? Well, the way we do that is by, in our pulse sequence, right? So here is our 90 degree RF pulse, and we are going to sample over here at TE. What we do is turn on a series of 90 degree RF pulses that are unique in that these RF pulses are slice selective for the tissue just above the slice that we are interested in imaging to generate this MRA image. What does that mean? This looks similar to what? This process that I'm doing here looks similar to what? Fat suppression, right? A series of RF pulses very close together cause saturation. Instead of tuning these to fat and applying them to the whole volume we're imaging, we are tuning them with the slice select gradient to a specific swath of tissue. And this is often called a saturation band. In this type of 2D time of flight MRA, this has to be applied before every single iteration of the pulse sequence. And in fact, it's designed so that this saturation band is applied adjacent to whichever slice we're about to acquire. So as we move through the volume of tissue, the saturation band moves, and we sometimes call it a walking or marching saturation band as we go through the volume. If you were interested, for whatever reason, in a venogram of the neck, what would you do? Yeah, all you would do is take this and put it down here. And again, it would move for each slice. You would just move it up right next to that individual slice.
Could you be acquiring the images in the opposite direction?
Okay, good point. If you were interested in the veins, you would be acquiring the images in the opposite direction. Yep, with the direction of flow. Absolutely right. If you want to do a venogram of the brain, which would be a more typical clinical application, you would, place this over the neck and do your time of flight imaging over the head. All of the arterial flow going into the head is now wiped out, and all we see is the venous flow going in the other direction. If you're doing an MRA, an arteriogram of the brain, you put one of these things up here to quash signal in the superior sagittal sinus that will be coming back down as venous flow. Okay, so any questions about this, about 2D time of flight MRA? One of the issues, as you guys know, we'll take these images and put them into a computer and render this nice 3D picture of what the flow looks like using something called a maximum intensity projection. We're not here to talk about that kind of stuff. But an issue to be aware of is that each of these slices is acquired totally independently of the other. And it takes time to do this. Right? It might take, 3, 4, 5, 7 minutes. During that period of time, if the patient isn't perfectly still, if they swallow, if they sneeze, if they cough, if they move, their neck may be in a different position where each of these slices are acquired. And we get these so-called, Venetian blind or stair step artifacts in the reconstruction, which is simply a motion artifact between the slices. Now, there's another approach to doing time of flight MRA, which is using the 3D Fourier transform, or using volumetric imaging. So what that would mean is that, again, if we're looking at the neck, sorry for my deformed patients here. So if we're looking at the neck, instead of acquiring all of these individual slices, it would mean that we excite a single slab axial slab, volume of tissue, and using our 3D time of flight technique, partition that into individual slices. Why would you want to do this? First of all, we know that the imaging time for a 2D image is the TR times the number of phase encoding steps. In this case, since we're not doing multi-slice imaging, it's actually times the number of slices. Okay. If we're doing 3D imaging, turns out that it's actually about the same. It's the TR times the number of phase encoding steps times the number of partitions or slices. That was that extra little bit of phase encoding in the slice direction that we had to add in. So it turns out that if you're not doing multi-slice imaging, there isn't a huge difference in terms of time. But what would be a potential advantage to doing 3D time of flight? Well, let's say that we're imaging the carotids. And this is a non-healthy person. And they have some area of stenosis in the carotid, an area of narrowing. So we all know that when you have an area of narrowing, you get turbulent flow. And we've already discussed how that turbulent flow can lead to loss of signal. As a result, when you look at the sort of final MRA image, when you reconstruct it as a MIP, what it looks like, you might see the carotid coming up here and see it continuing up here and be completely missing this segment. Surgeons always call this a flow gap. Basically, there's turbulence, which is destroying the signal so that it looks as if there is no vessel there. Now, we can infer from that that there's a high-grade stenosis. But the bottom line is you really can't delineate very well what is going on. So turbulence leads to this appearance of absent signal because within the voxel, all of our spins have their phase randomized by the mechanical disruption of the turbulence. If we take a large enough area, a large enough sample of spins, their phase will be extremely random. If we narrow ourselves down to a very small volume of tissue, it's more likely that we will be capturing some segment of the flow which will not have as much of this turbulence effect. So by improving the resolution of the image, we can actually make ourselves less sensitive to this turbulence and actually image what's going on there, actually see the contours of the stenosis, for example. So there's a limitation when we do 2D time of flight imaging in that because our RF slice selection is not perfect, and our ability to detect very, very thin slices by using that slice selection is limited. You know, we're limited to slices that are at least, let's say, 2 millimeters thick, if not even thicker. But in 3D time of flight, since we're not using slice selection to separate our images in the slice direction, but we're using the same phase encoding process we use in the plane of the slice, the only limitation on how thin we can make these is whether there's enough signal to noise, whether there's enough signal in the resulting partition for us to get useful information. And we can routinely get partitions that are a millimeter or less, meaning these voxels can become dramatically smaller. So one of the important roles of 3D Fourier transform imaging in time of flight MRA is to improve resolution and limit our susceptibility to turbulence-induced signal loss, which is not only in the presence of a stenosis. In the head, this is extremely important because unlike the carotids, which are large vessels that run relatively straight through the neck, right? If you look anywhere in the brain, there is all kinds of tortuosity, there are many branches, and all of those anatomic features cause turbulence, which leads to dephasing. So 3D time of flight is really essential for imaging the head. Now, another thing we talked about with 3D time of flight imaging is that since we excite this large, thick slab of tissue, when we write our signal, acquire each signal and write it into K-space, each time we fill one of these lines, that signal is coming from a large volume of tissue, as opposed to 2D time of flight, where each signal is only coming from a thin slice. So the inherent signal to noise of 3D time of flight imaging is much better than 2D time of flight. Yes?
Does that also make you more sensitive to motion, though? Because if the patient moves, okay, you're affecting every pixel in the whole volume.
So that's absolutely right. So if the patient moves, right, then we do have a problem. But by the same token, we have that problem with 2D time of flight. Maybe not within an individual slice, but certainly from slice to slice. And the biggest limitation, you know, as I was talking about over here in terms of motion, generally, you know, has to do with the alignment of the individual slices. Now, if you have really bad motion in a 3D time of flight acquisition, yes, it's going to make all of your images look bad. But on the other hand, by the way, if the patient only moves once during the whole exam, let's say you're doing a 2D time of flight image and the patient coughs or swallows during this scan. So between those two slices, there will now be this large offset. And if that shows up right where you're interested in looking, that's going to be a big problem. In 3D time of flight, on the other hand, we are filling up this large three-dimensional K-space. And remember, every time we acquire a signal, it's coming from the whole volume of tissue, and essentially it's all being averaged out over that entire acquisition. So if there's one moment in time during that acquisition where there's a slight amount of movement, it may not have as bad an effect overall. So it's not actually, it may be less sensitive to motion in some sense. Okay? So the two main reasons why we're going to do this are to improve our spatial resolution, which improves our issues with sensitivity to turbulence, and in order to improve signal to noise. Okay, what might be a problem with 3D time of flight imaging? Well, think about this example with the carotids. As one of our vessels is coursing through this slab, right, those spins are flowing along. Every time we turn on our RF, we are applying it to this entire volume of tissue. While we have unsaturated spins that flow into the bottom of the volume, they are going to experience many iterations of the RF pulse as they progressively move through this volume. And there will be significant saturation as we get through this volume. 2D time of flight, remember, each slice was acquired independently. There was basically no issue of saturation whatsoever. Okay? That's a problem. And it limits the amount of territory that you can cover in a single 3D acquisition. So for example, we could never do an entire neck as one 3D time of flight acquisition. This is not a possibility. There would be so much saturation that we probably wouldn't even see the bifurcation, right, let alone the distal part of the carotids. And if we want to do 3D time of flight, we would need to limit ourselves to a small volume. Okay? Now, there are things that can be done to improve this saturation situation, one of which is that the RF that is applied to these 3D slabs uses a special kind of RF pulse called a tone pulse. which stands for tilt-optimized non-saturating excitation, which basically means that if you think about it, the signal is maximal when the spins come into the slam. And if we give a standard regular RF pulse, that signal will be minimal at the other end of the slam. So what we do is design an RF pulse where the magnitude transmitted to the lower end of the slab causes a smaller flip angle. So we have a lot of magnetization, and we only turn a small amount of it into signal, preserving longitudinal magnetization so that with saturation, right, we don't have as much saturation. This is like choosing the Ernst angle. We don't want to set with our very short TR, we don't want to saturate our spins at this end of the slab. By the time we're at the other end of the slab, where the magnetization is already saturated, we use a larger flip angle to generate as much signal as we can from the little amount of magnetization that's left. But even with that type of approach, there's still a limitation to how thick you can make these slabs. Now, there is one hybrid approach which gets around this, and that is acquiring a series of 3D slabs. And typically, we acquire these 3D slabs so that they overlap each other. That way, when we put them together and generate our reconstructed 3D images, they give us much smoother reconstructions. And that approach is called a multiple overlapping thin slab acquisition, right, or MOTSA. And this is a technique that we use pretty routinely to image the neck. Because with multiple thin slabs, you have the ability to cover as much territory as you want, not limited by saturation. Because each individual 3D acquisition is thin enough that it has a tolerable amount of saturation. And we have the advantage of high spatial resolution and high signal to noise to deal with things like stenosis and turbulence. Any questions about time of flight, MRA? So this, for example, this is basically the way we image the carotids and the head. Right? Most body MRA applications, while they can be done using these techniques, and while people are looking into these techniques more because of recent concerns about giving gadolinium and NSF, generally, you know, you're probably used to mostly seeing contrast-enhanced approaches in other parts of the body, which we'll talk about after lunch. But this is the workhorse of MRA. So let's just look at a few images. So this is the same person and the exact same MRA study. The only thing that has been changed is that on your left, we applied our spatial presaturation. Do this. We applied our spatial presaturation up here to remove the veins, and in this case, we applied it down in the neck to remove signal flowing in from the arteries. So we get an arteriogram and a venogram of the head. Okay. So on the left, this is 2D time of flight MRA. Notice how we're able to cover the entire neck without any saturation. There's no narrowing of these, of this carotid as you move further and further up into the neck, because each slice is acquired individually. And when the patient, right, swallows, you get this misregistration artifact. Okay. This is 3D time of flight, where we're limited. Right? We had to choose, in this case, a segment of the carotid at the bifurcation, which we can get with high signal to noise and high spatial resolution. Right? We don't have that little misregistration artifact, but the coverage is not the same. Now, so here's another example of 2D time of flight on the left and 3D time of flight on the right. So this person has, right, what looks like a carotid occlusion. However, right, we do see the rest of the cervical carotid. And you guys all know, right, since there are no branches in the cervical carotid, there's no reason why we should have an occlusion and then reconstitute the distal part of the cervical carotid. So if you look at the 3D time of flight image, you can actually see that there is this tapered stenosis, which we even saturate some of that out completely, but we do a much better job using 3D time of flight than 2D time of flight. And this is simply a function of the added spatial resolution and the added signal to noise of 3D time of flight. So this is just another example, 2D on the right and 3D on the left. So we do a pretty good job with 2D time of flight, but in terms of being able to sort of exactly determine where the contours of this irregular stenosis are, we see it much better because we don't have as much sensitivity to turbulence-induced dephasing and because we have higher spatial resolution. This is another issue with 2D time of flight MRA. With 2D time of flight, these are two-dimensional Fourier transform images. They're relatively thick slices. What's going on here? This is actually the course of the carotid. So what's going on there? Not turbulence. It's not turbulence. Miss what? No, it's not misregistered. This was a perfect patient. They held perfectly still. So the anatomy of this person's carotid is such that it flows during this segment and partially during this segment up here in the plane of the slice. What does that mean? That means that as the blood was flowing through the slice, it was being subject to multiple RF pulses and became saturated. Unlike our typical example where we have a transverse slice and there is constant refreshment with unsaturated spins, whenever we have flow in the plane of the slice, we're going to have saturation. If you look at this with 3D time of flight, right, you can see the vessel. Now, another curiosity here is that this is a multi-slab, right? This is matzo. This is one of the interfaces of the slabs. If you notice how there's some tapering of this carotid, that's vertebral, sorry, and then it expands a little bit. And similarly, how there is some saturation, and then all of a sudden it expands to a larger diameter. Maybe I'm obscuring it too much. That's because even within the 3D slab, by the time we got to the end of that slab, there's some saturation. Right. This is just to show you what the so-called source images look like. High signal due to flow, and not very good ability to tell very much about the rest of the tissue. We're saturating the background, just trying to maximize contrast between flow and everything else. Okay, this is another example. Now, this is a very old study. This is a lousy, obviously, lousy quality MRA from a scanner that we haven't had for years. This is a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 slab acquisition. So these are 5 3D slabs. And the reason that I show this to you is because you can see how when you get to the edges of these slabs that there is saturation of flow. So an example where we didn't do a very good job shows you this issue with 3D time of flight, that as you get to the edge of the slab, if you make it too thick, you can have some saturation. All right, so this is something that we actually didn't talk about yet. If we do an MRA of the neck, let's say, a time of flight MRA study. So our stationary spins are being knocked down into this very low steady state by the short TR. And the flowing spins all of a sudden show up with fully relaxed magnetization. And when we give that RF pulse, we have a large amount of signal from flow. Right? That's the way it works. What if we have something in there which has an extremely short T1? Well, what that means is that even with our short TR, if it's recovering very rapidly, we will still see a large amount of signal due to that extremely short T1. In fact, if you think about, we said this before, if you think about the nature of the inflowing blood, it's really as if it has an infinitely short T1. We sometimes say its apparent T1 is extremely short. So if we do have something which is a tissue which has an extremely short T1, so this person has a dissection of the carotid artery. They have high signal on these two T1 weighted images in the carotid because the methemoglobin in this hematoma, we'll talk about that a little bit more tomorrow, causes a, right? Methemoglobin is one of those things that causes a dramatic shortening of T1. So when we look at a flow sensitive image in the head, right, not down at this level but up in the head, we can see that there is flow related enhancement in the carotid on the unaffected side and in the basilar artery. We don't detect any flow related enhancement in the carotid up in the head because it's occluded down in the neck. And if we look at the MRA image, the reconstructed MIP image of the neck, we see our carotid and vertebral artery. And this area of signal, which runs along the course of the internal carotid artery, is showing up, even though all of the rest of the background tissue is totally saturated, it shows up as high signal, right? Simply because of the very short T1. Right? So this is one of the pitfalls that you have to be aware of in time of flight MRA, is this T1 shine through artifact. And typically, if you're looking, for example, for a dissection, this is a potentially dangerous technique to use because you can be misled by the appearance of high signal in the vessel that does not represent flow but represents hematoma. Similarly, if you had a lipoma or you had a parenchymal hematoma, those things can also show up on your MRA images. Any questions about this or any of this stuff about time of flight MRA? Nothing? Okay, so why don't we start up again at 1:00?